So we came to the point that Sir Alexander Heathcote got permission from the Empress. A year has passed. Let us see what has happened. Almost a year to the day, the minister, accompanied by the mandarin, set out again from Peking for the village of Halichuan. The same mandarin and the minister is traveling to Halichuan. When Sir Alexander arrived, he immediately dismounted from his horse and entered the workshop that he remembered so well. The old man was seated at his bench, his flat hat slightly askew, a piece of uncarved ivory held lovingly between his fingers. He was at his work. He looked up from his work and shuffled towards the minister. Shuffled means walked with dragging feet. Not recognizing his guest immediately until he could almost touch the foreign giant. Then he bowed low. The minister spoke through the mandarin. "I have returned, sir, within the calendar year to repay my debt." "There was no need, Your Excellency. My family is honored that the little statue lives in a great embassy and may one day be admired by the people of your own land." The minister could think of no words to form an adequate reply and simply requested that the old man should accompany him on a short journey. So they are going together. The craftsman agreed without question, and the three men set out on donkeys towards the north. They traveled for over 2 hours by a thin winding path into the hills behind the craftsman's workshop. When they reached the village of Ma Tien, they were met by another mandarin. These mandarins have locations. They will move only in this place. Next place, the next, there will be a mandarin in that locality. So that mandarin took over, who bowed low to the minister and requested Sir Alexander and the craftsman to continue their journey with him on foot. They walked in silence to the far side of the village and only stopped when they reached a hollow in the hill. Can imagine how beautiful it will be. A hill is carved out, a hollow is carved out, from which there was a magnificent view of the valley all the way down to Halichuan. In the hollow stood a newly completed small white house of the most perfect proportions. A beautiful small white house was there inside the hollow of the hill. Two stone lion dogs, you must have seen in some houses or at the gate, lion will be carved out, sometimes elephants, two lion dogs, tongues hanging over their lips, guarded the front entrance. The little old craftsman, who had not spoken since he had left his workshop, remained mystified by the purpose of the journey until the minister turned to him and offered. So he is wondering why he is bringing me to this house, this beautiful house, and asking and standing there. "A small inadequate gift and my feeble attempt to repay you in kind. This is my gift to you, my dear fellow." The craftsman fell to his knees and begged forgiveness of the mandarin. He immediately fell down on his knees and he started crying, "Oh, sorry, sorry, it was not me. I did not say anything." He was scared because he was not supposed to, as he knew it was forbidden for an artisan to accept gifts from a foreigner, another Chinese tradition. The mandarin raised the frightened blue figure from the ground, explaining to his countryman that the Empress herself had sanctioned the minister's request. A smile of joy came over the face of the craftsman, and he slowly walked up to the doorway of the beautiful little house. Unable to resist running his hand over the carved lion dogs, the three travelers spent over an hour admiring the little house before returning in silent mutual happiness back to the workshop in Halichuan. Why mutual happiness? Young Li is satisfied and happy. Sir Alexander is also happy that he hasn't hurt this man. The two men thus parted, honor satisfied. And Sir Alexander wrote to his embassy that night, content that his actions had met with the approval of the Bandaran as well as Lady Heathcote. So he was very happy. He was very happy that he had done his duty. A year had passed, so maybe the time for Sir Alexander Heathcote for return also must have come. So how did he repay? Which are the points that you should say? You should say about how he is trying to find out the value and what was the value, how he consulted Lady Heathcote, from where the money came, how did he collect the information from the Mandaren, how did he get a sanction from the emperors, how did he come back to the workshop, traveled to the hills, and how it was handed over, what was the reaction of young Lee, and who pacified him, and how did they return till their death. All these points must be written to show how the gift was returned. So we stop there. Thank you.